Yeah, we have a slide for our title this morning. As we come to the end of this year and we come to the Christmas season, I think it's important to reflect upon this and see the big picture of the cosmos and the eternal and the eternal view, and think of Christmas not as a commercial holiday, but think of Christmas as a plan, a cosmic event that God has orchestrated years and years and years ago, way before the foundation of the world, way before you were even a little tiny baby. God had a plan. You were involved in that plan, even though you are so little in your life. But in the plan of God, you are important. Hallelujah. And sometimes when we go through crisis, our own crisis, it's easy. The first thing we do is like we always go back. Is God is in control. God knows what I'm going through. And the panic comes and grip our hearts. When you see the chaos in the world, when you read the bad news every day, because these are the bad news. I don't know why we are so much hooked. Every day we want to watch the news, and we always watch the bad news because it's always getting bad and worse. And then when you think of your own crisis and your own trouble, there's a French philosopher who said, the universe is indifferent. Who created it? Who governed it? Why are we here on this puny mud puddle or heap spinning in an infinite space? I have not the slightest idea, and I am quite convinced that no one has the least idea. That's not really hopeful in this statement. This universe is just like a big bang, and it's just going on. We don't know who's governing it. Nobody's in control of it. And that tells us that there is no God. But as Christian, I think I want this morning that we begin to see how the events of history and the circumstances of even our lives and the people that we read about in the Bible fit in the purpose that God is working out, how important these are. One of the things I want to also point before we go further in our message, and you can give us the next slide. Look at some of the scriptures that we have here. The Lord has made the heavens his throne. From there, he rules over everything. Wow, that's so glorious. But there's one thing that I have noticed reading this text is that from there, it looks like a distant God. He's big. He's strong, he's in control, he governs, but he governs from far away. From there, he rules over everything. And we feel a bit of a distance when you read that. Deuteronomy 10:14, look, the highest heavens and the earth, and everything in it, all belong to the Lord your God. Everything belongs to the Lord. You and I, our possessions, whatever exists. Daniel 4:35. This is Nebuchadnezzar after he came back from his insanity that expressed in this way. All the people of the earth are nothing compared to him. He does as he pleases among the angels of heaven and among the people of the earth. No one can stop him or say to him, what do you mean by doing these things? He does as he pleases. And it says all the people of the earth are nothing compared to him. In a way, it's true. We are little in comparison when you think that there is a great God, a creator that is eternal, that has a plan for all eternity. Then you feel really, really tiny when you think about that. But no matter how tiny you may feel this morning, you are important to God. You know, one of the greatest mystery of this cosmic plan of that God has is that God has chosen to enter this world. That is the most revealing act of love and significance that you and I, we can have. Think about it. Remove the birth of Jesus from the Bible. What do you have? You may have like, from there he rules everything, but not from here in your home, in your office, and your daily life. Think of all these wonderful Bible stories you read in the New Testament, where Jesus comes into this world and goes on walking just like you and I, meeting people just like you and I, and identifying with their suffering and their pains of every day. Think of these stories. this woman, this father and mother, who had lost a daughter 10 years old, and she's dead. And Jesus comes in their home and brings this daughter back to life. Think of the woman with a demon-possessed daughter, and she has nowhere to turn, no hope. She goes to Jesus, and Jesus at first seems to test her faith and her ability to trust in him, almost like discouraging her. And she holds on to her faith, and she pleads with Jesus, and Jesus healed her. Think of this man who had a son that was maybe epileptic. We don't really know what it is, or a demon was causing this epilepsy. And he's coming, pleading for his son. So this is just like you and me. The greatest crisis that you and I will go through in our lives are family crises. You may have money problems, you may have all sorts of problems, but when it touched to your family, when it touched to your marriage, when it touched to your children, when it touched to your husband, when it touched to your wife, this is definitely the biggest crisis. That brings you to your knees. But imagine the Bible without these encounters of Jesus. Remove all of these encounters where Jesus touched individuals just like you and me. What would you have? Do you follow me? You remove all of these special moments where Jesus intervenes in the life of individuals just like you and me. And that tells you a lot. So that's why I'm saying that this message of Christmas is so important. Because God had taken flesh. He has identified with you. He has come to seek and to save and to touch and to reveal and to continue to further his plan, because that's been his plan all along. Hallelujah. Amen? Amen. Though God is unseen, have you ever seen God? No, God is unseen. But we believe that he is sovereign. He is not only the creator of this world, but he is also actively at work, but unrecognized. He's working, but you don't see him working. And I will give you some examples. He's working behind world events. You don't see the things, but we know it by the Bible that he has been dead working to bring about a purpose that he determined from the beginning. And that is big to me when I think about that. Before the foundation of the world, God has a determined purpose. This is where he's going. And he's looking ahead thousands of years. Like me, I cannot think past a few days. Sometimes I may plan like a vacation or something that I would like to do. But I'm not really a big planner, a life planner. Like if you ask me, what are your goals for 10 years? I don't have an answer for that. But God has an answer for that. If you ask God, what's your plan for 10 years? He will tell you what's his plan for 10 years. Maybe he will not tell you, but he has a plan. If you tell him, what is your plan for 100 years from now? Do you know your plans for 100 years? Yes. What will you be doing? Pastor Jennifer knows the plan she has for 100 years from now. She will be in heaven, she says. Praise God. Hallelujah. I hope we all have this plan made up. Hallelujah. Praise God. But it tells you something about God. God sees further than we see. He's unseen. He works behind the scene. And I want to show you some wonderful example of that. When the Lord sent Joseph ahead to his brothers in Egypt. Next slide. Psalm 105. This is a wonderful text. God called for a famine on the land of Canaan. Look, stop there. Wow, that's not very positive. Well, God is doing something mean, something bad. He's causing trouble. He's bringing a famine, a crisis in the land, no food in the fridge, a difficult time, loss of job. You're like, put it in modern times. A crisis is happening. There's a serious crisis. There's no food. How many like that to have no food in your fridge? Yeah. Okay, so this is what happened. There's no food in the fridge. So he's cutting off their food supply. Then he sent someone to Egypt ahead of them, Joseph. But how did he send him? With his white horses, as an ambassador, as a king? No, he sent him as a slave. Another crisis, another bad event in the life of someone. Isn't it terrible? Wow, we just start to read this text and already two bad things caused by God. This is really awful. Wow, where is God when all these troubles come? And then look at the next verse. The hope is coming. Until the time came to fulfill his dreams. Oh, now I understand something, that the dreams that Jacob had were really dreams from God. Joseph, thank you. What did I say?
Jacob.
Jacob also had a dream, and it was also from God. Yes, but that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about Joseph. You know, sometimes when I read the Genesis, the stories of Joseph, I've never saw that the dreams of Joseph were from God. You don't read it. You just read that Joseph had a dream. And then the rest of his life is, you know, written. That's why I'm saying God is working behind the world event. This is leading us to a major crisis. A world event like never seen before. 14 years of crisis. 7 years of tremendous world epidemic or something horrible that is happening, worse than tsunami. It lasts 7 years. And God was behind the scene until the time came to fulfill the dreams that God had given to Joseph. Isn't it wonderful? And during this time, what was God doing? God was testing Joseph's character. Oh, so God is working in many ways, isn't it? He's working on the international sphere. He's working in the famine. He's working in the injustice of Joseph. He's working in sending him in prison. How many of you would like to be sent to prison for God? No, nobody? You don't want to do God's will. This is God's will. God's will to send Joseph into prison, but none of us wants to do it. Okay, that's why he chose Joseph, I guess. And he's testing his character. Then Pharaoh, who was the most important person in the whole world at that time, sent for him. This is also doesn't make sense. Whose king, whose prime minister or president will call upon a prisoner to become his first right-hand counselor, secretary of state, you know? Nobody is doing that to humble themselves to a stupid prisoner in prison that, you know, even not from our own country and our own nationality. But the ruler of the nation opened the prison door, and it is God fulfilling the dream that he had. And Joseph, from this bad circumstance that he was in, became ruler over all the king's possessions. He could instruct the king's aides as he pleased. He became more important than the ministers of justice, than the ministers of health, than the ministers of finance. He became more important than all of them. And he instructed them as he pleased. That's Joseph we're talking about, the slave in prison. Then all of this was so that the people of God, Israel, would be spared from a famine. These 70 people would come into Egypt under the protection of the greatest nation on the world, having the best land of the country to dwell in. And for 400 years, they were going to dwell and multiply under the blessing of God. And nobody knows that God is working behind the scene. That's the beauty of it. This is a great world event, and nobody sees that God is there. When you read this text, you find out he's fulfilling his plan. Another text that is also wonderful, the next slide. It's 400 years later. Wow. Do you have a plan for 400 years from now? Years passed, and the king of Egypt died. Maybe you will be dead also in 400 years from now. But the Israelites continued to groan under the burden of slavery. They cried for help, and their cry rose up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered his covenant promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He looked down on his people of Israel and knew it was time to to act. I like that when it talks about the time. God knows this is the time. The time has come 400 years later. If you look at the next slide, you will see God behind the scene. He turned the Egyptians against the Israelites. Whoa, God made them their enemies. You know, this is God's people, Paul. But what this Pharaoh who respected Joseph died, and the next one was evil, did not know what Joseph had done, did not recognize the work that Joseph prevented the Egyptian to become like enslaved themselves or poor. But the Lord sent his servant Moses, along with Aaron, whom he had chosen, they performed miraculous signs among the Egyptians and wonders. Amen. You see God working. When you start reading this text, you may feel that God is sitting on his throne, fiddling with his fingers, looking by the window of heaven, if there is ever a window in heaven, and he's just waiting for something to happen. Years pass, they are there, they are groaning, it's 400 years later, and nothing is happening. But then suddenly he knew that it was time to act, and he had a plan for that. And his plan was wonderful. During these years, what happened? When this king became very filled with animosity against the Israelites, God made sure that Moses' life would be spared miraculously. When they wanted to kill all the boys of the land, he directed the little basket floating on the Nile River. This is a big river. And he's just guiding this little basket to Pharaoh's daughter. This is God's doing. Moses means save from the waters. That's his name. He's been saved. He had put thoughts in Moses' mind that he could be Israel's deliverer. That's why Moses took upon himself to kill the Egyptian at that time. He already felt this a burden already deposited in his heart, but it was not the time and it was not the way that God would work. Then he spared Moses' life when he led him into the wilderness. And during these long years, when he lived with his father-in-law, he was preparing him to lead his people out of Egypt. Who initiated all of this? We find it in the book of Genesis, when God had already prophesied. Think about it. This is big. This is big. In Genesis, God, when he spoke to Abraham, already prophesied that his people would be enslaved in Egypt for 400 years. God has already said that 400 years before that this would happen, even before that, but for 400 years. And then he moved to bring the children of Abraham out of captivity, which he also arranged. It's nothing to God to think 400 years ahead. It's nothing to God to intervene into your life. Can you plan that long? Can you plan for your granddaughters and your grandsons and your great, 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 great children? Because 400 years is a lot of great. How did Israel get out of Egypt? They didn't get into a rebellion, a revolution, or a spy agency, or diplomatic negotiations with the United Nations. They got out because God wanted them out, and it was part of God's larger purpose. The most wonderful things you can see when you read the Bible, the Old Testament, is the big picture. God is always pointing to the larger purpose. And then, another wonderful story, it was the Lord who called Cyrus, a pagan ruler. He called him his anointed one because he was going to use him to accomplish his will for his people. You can see it in the next slide. You can read about the working of God. You know, God was even working in the hearts of unbelieving rulers. And he would stir them to do unexpected actions of generosity, actions of goodness. I mean, they are pagan kings. They have nothing to do with Israel and God. But God is strong enough and powerful enough to move their hearts without their knowledge. Who has stirred up this king from the east, rightly calling him into God's service? Who gives this man victory over many nations? Who has done such mighty deeds, summoning each new generation from the beginning of time? Just stop at this expression. Who has done such mighty deeds? Who can do something like that? To summon each new generation from the beginning of time. And each generation, God has a people. God has a plan for each generation. That would be something for you and me. We are in a generation. And he summons, and he plans, and he will use the church of 2016-17 worldwide. He will do something through his church, even through unbelieving government leaders. He will do his plan, is going ahead, is going to go. God's summoning each new generation from the beginning of time. It is I, the Lord, the first and the last, I alone am he. That's the God that you know. So if you ask yourself the question when you go through your crisis, is God in control? Does God care? Does God know? Can God do something? Remember all these wonderful stories, what God is doing. The first and the last is way before your time, is going to be there way after your time. When you are not there, your children, your children's children will have to deal with God. He will be there. He will be at the faithful God to them as he has been to you. That's why it says in the Bible that the righteous children and the children's children are going to be blessed by God. Because God is like that. He works, he has a plan, and his plan goes on. Click at the next slide. Talking about Cyrus. Listen to me, Israel, my chosen one. I alone am God, the first and the last. It was my hand that laid the foundation of the earth, my right hand that spread out the heavens. When I call out the stars, they all appear in order. Have any of your idols ever told you this? Come, all of you, and listen. The Lord has chosen Cyrus as his ally. He will use him to put an end to the empire of Babylon and to destroy the Babylonian armies. I have said it. I am calling Cyrus. I will send him on this errand, and I will help him to succeed. What a wonderful text. Cyrus, do you know how many times it took between this text to the coming of Cyrus? 150 years before. He was not born. He did not even exist yet. And you're talking about world history, controlling, having influence and impact directly in world history. If you remember the story in Daniel, the king had the vision of the statue, all the parts of the statue represents an empire and the history of this world. Each one of them to the Roman Empire, starting from the Babylonian, the Medes and the Persians, and then you had the Greek, Alexander the Greek, and all this. World history is explained by God. God has a hand. He has given a vision, a dream to the king about what was going to come in terms of world history. And now he's going again to do it again. How many years? 150 years before. He's going to send him against, and he's going to use him to destroy an empire and establish a new empire. Turn to the next verse, Ezra 1:1. In the first year of King Cyrus of Persia, the Lord fulfilled the prophecy he had given through Jeremiah. He stirred the heart of Cyrus to put this proclamation in writing and to send it throughout his kingdom. The prophecy of Jeremiah is another one. It's the prophecy that they would be in captivity for 70 years. So that refers to that prophecy. The prophecy of Isaiah 150 years before announced the birth and the conquest of Cyrus. But the prophecy of Jeremiah has to do with the time that they will be in deportation and the time that they will come back and return to Israel. This is about 100 years before this time come. And you see God behind the scene. But and when you read the stories in the Bible, if you don't pay attention to these texts, you don't see God. End of these stories. You just see world event being unfold. But God is there all the time. He's been there. Amen? Hallelujah. Praise God. And there's a text, I don't have it here, but let me just refer to that. It's in the same chapter of Isaiah 48. God is saying, as an application, this is an application for you and for me. If God can do this, then God is saying that to you and me. Come closer, listen to this. From the beginning, I have told you plainly what would happen. He's referring to that. This is what the Lord says, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. I am the Lord your God who teaches you what is good for you. Isn't that a good application? It says, listen, if I can do this, will you not trust me when I give you instructions, when I give you my word, when I give you prophecies, when I give you commands, when I tell you to do or not to do, to stay out or to walk on the narrow road, whenever I give you an instruction, won't you trust me that I know what I'm talking about? That's what God is saying to us as an application. I am the Lord your God who teaches you what is good for you and leads you along the path you should follow. So what do you and I need to do? Listen, obey, trust, stay close on the narrow road and walk with God. The rest will be fine. It says, oh, if you would have listened to my commands, then you would have had peace flowing like a gentle river and righteousness rolling over like a waves of the sea. Because we know what's coming after that, that prophecy. Years of wars, famine, deportation, and punishment because they rebel against God, because they didn't listen. So God says, listen, if I can't do that, don't be fooled. Don't do your own things. Don't walk independently of me. Trust me. Trust me with your life. Obey and live according to my standards. That's what God is calling us to do. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. One more. Artaxerxes. If you look for a name for your son, Artaxerxes, okay, we can dedicate him here in Lighthouse anytime. Ezra left Babylon. Next, where are we? Yeah, okay. Ezra left Babylon on April 8th. This is after the deportation, they are coming back. And this is the second trip of Ezra back to rebuild the temple. Not the city, but the temple. Ezra left Babylon on April 8th. He arrived at Jerusalem on August 4. Why? Because the gracious hand of his God was on him. Because Ezra had determined to study and obey the law of the Lord, God's blessing was on his journey when he went there. King Artaxerxes had given a copy of the following letter to Ezra. You are to give Ezra, the priest and teacher of the law of the God of heaven, whatever he requests of you. This is a pagan king. It has nothing to do with Israel. And he's commanding, I want to honor this God, their God. And whoever and the land, the prime ministers, the deputies, or whatever it is that would not listen to that, they're going to be put to death. They have to obey. This is an ungodly king. Praise the Lord. Then Ezra comes to this conclusion after his trip. Praise the Lord, the God of our ancestors who made the king want to beautify the temple of the Lord in Jerusalem. Who made the king want to beautify the temple of the Lord in Jerusalem? Who made him? God, yes. And praise him, God, for demonstrating such unfailing love to who? To me. To you. It's like it's becoming like this great God that works and influence kingdoms and rulers of the world, Christian or non-Christian, those people or not, is also working in me, you, and people who are faithful to him. If you look about Ezra, he had determined to study and obey the law of the Lord. The gracious hand of the Lord was upon him. He was a faithful follower of God, and God put his gracious hand upon him for his life, to give him success, to use him in fulfilling his plan. Because God put in the heart of that king to beautify the temple of God in Jerusalem. But for that, he had to use somebody. And somebody was Ezra. Why Ezra? Because Ezra had the heart that was pleasing the Lord. He was close to the Lord. He read the word of the Lord, and he taught the word of the Lord, and he lived by the word of the Lord, and he was sensitive to the leading of God. So God blessed him and gave him success. So you see, God works on the big scale, and he works in smaller scale, and you and for me. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. It says, I felt encouraged because the gracious hand of my Lord was on me, and I gathered some of the leaders of Israel. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. So let's go to the end now. Jesus is the centerpiece of civilization. All the lines of history converge on Jesus. Actually, if you look to the next slide, his story is his story. That's the story of Jesus. If you look in the mind of God, when God talks about his story, what he's working behind the scene, it's all pointing to his story. That's the climax. That's the beginning and the end. That's the intention. That was his plan all along, to bring Jesus in this picture. The greatest moment of history was the birth of Jesus. That is why we live according to the calendar we have. You know, we have a lunar calendar. We have the Maya's calendar that prophesied the end of the world this year or last year, and it didn't happen. And then we have all sorts of, calendar and things like this. But we have the Gregorian calendar, what we call, because Pope Gregory recognized this importance of this cosmic event, the coming of Jesus Christ, as the hinge of history is on the door of a Bethlehem stable. This is when the world has changed. As I was telling you at the beginning of the message, remove the part of Jesus from the Bible where he's touching people's life, and you would not be able to identify with the love of Jesus, pray like you pray, be confident in your crisis, keep on having hope, thinking that God can heal you, touch you, change your life, or change your loved one, or save your family. You could not imagine these things really easily. You agree with me? Without having all of these wonderful stories, when Jesus came, he came humble, as it was prophesied, you can click. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, are only a small village among all the people of Judah, and yet a ruler of Israel will come from you, one whose origins are from the distant past or from eternity. Again, you see these wonderful texts here. It tells you so much about the plan of God, the calendar of God, the agenda of God, and it rules that Christmas is the important entry point of Jesus Christ into this world to make a difference. Last Monday, I was at the gym with my trainer, and I was asking him about Christmas. I'm working. He's a Hong Kong guy. He's working in physical gym, and Christmas is not a holiday for him. This is a working day. So I'm talking about Christmas, and he's not really into Christmas because, why Christmas? It's only an opportunity to go shopping and to buy expensive gifts, because at Christmas season, all the products are more expensive. So that's clever way of thinking. Says Christmas is only to give opportunity to the people in commerce and business to jack the price so that you will pay more money when you buy something. Okay, fine. He's right when he says that. So I'm explaining to him what is the meaning between the gift exchange, because that has a meaning. Why do we in Christianity have a tradition to give gifts? It's because we point to the gift that God has given. For God so loved the world that he gave the most important. So I'm explaining to him, his name is Teddy, I'm explaining to him, that's why this is a very, very important, maybe you did not know that, but Christmas is very important because Jesus came into the world to save you. You are included in the big plan of God. He has given his life. He is your savior. So I'm explaining to him. And my wife in school, this week when she finished, just before the holiday, the teacher asked the fifth graders, what are you going to do during Christmas time? And they said, watching TV and playing computer game. Which is what people do nowadays. So the teacher reacted and says, what? Do you think this is how Jesus wants you to celebrate Christmas? And, you know, Christmas is big. Christmas is big. Can you turn to your neighbor and says, Christmas is big. It's really, really big. So when next time when you wonder, is God in control my life? Remember Christmas and let Christmas answer the question that you may have. Just, this is so important. Next slide. Christmas is so big. I think it's before this one, Galatians, or maybe it was in the text before. Oh, yes, this one, okay. But when the fullness of time had come, there's a time for Christmas. There was a time for the entry of Jesus Christ. God sent his son, born of a woman under the law, at the right time, just as he wanted, to redeem, so that we will receive the spirit of adoptions that says, Abba, Father. This is a wonderful text. Let's go to the next one. And the greatest example of God at work in the event why Jesus came at Christmas, it's to go a little bit further. You read in the book of Acts, in the sermon, fellow Israelites, listen to these words. Jesus of Nazareth was a man authenticated to you by God through miracles. Already God was pointing how special he was. Wonders and signs that God performed through him among you as you yourselves know. After he was arrested, according, pay attention, to the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God. It was not a coincidence, it was not a mistake of history that Jesus Christ died. They killed him without knowing that they were actually fulfilling what God has already predetermined and knew in advance. This is big when you think about God in that way. How God knows all of these things. If you look at the next verse, he used again, He used again, Herod and Pontius Pilate. They met together with the Gentiles and the people to Israel to oppose Jesus, whom God had anointed, to carry out everything that your hand and will at predetermined to take place. This is why Jesus has come. This is why we celebrate Christmas, because Jesus is saving. Jesus is delivering. Jesus is doing something big. Next verse, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4. Even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into his family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him a great pleasure. It gave him a great pleasure that we are here today, the church, and this generation, because we are part of his big purpose. We exist for his purpose. It gives him a great, great pleasure that you responded by faith to the gifts of his son, that you allow your life to be molded by the word of God, that you say yes to the will of the Lord. Brother Chris, if you would want to join me here and the musician to prepare, we will sing at the end of the service. Hallelujah. Think about the big plan of God this morning. Can you close your eyes just a moment as we prepare to sing? Think of the big plan of God. As we approach Christmas, think of God fulfilling his agenda. God has sent his son into this world. Before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ. Hallelujah. Just hallelujah. And this is the secret truth, Paul says, that by hearing the good news, those who are not Jews will share with the Jews in the blessing God has for his people. They are part of the same body, and they share in the promise God made through Christ Jesus. This agrees with the plan God had since the beginning of time. He did what he planned, and he did it through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Hallelujah. Whenever things seem to have gone wrong in your life, when you're facing some kind of crisis, remind yourselves, the Lord reigns. God not only loves you, but he is also the sovereign Lord who is ultimately in control of your life. He is also in control of events and history. Mr. Tozer said, God is love and God is sovereign. His love disposes him to desire our everlasting welfare, and his sovereignty enables him to secure it. The love of God desires your eternal salvation and welfare and success and blessing. And the sovereignty of God makes it possible that it will take place in your life. Realizing that God is in charge of everything should bring comfort to your life today. In light of the problem that will come, if you understand that God is still in control of the situation, even though the situation may seem out of control, you can live and conduct your life by faith. God is fulfilling his agenda, and this Christmas is the proof of it. We want to sing Let Us Adore, especially the part of Eternity's King, because when I was singing that part, I think it's the verse maybe of Let Us Adore, Eternity is King. We want to start there and realize the big plan of God, what God is doing into your life. And next time you go through a crisis, don't lose hope. Hold on to God. Would you stand this morning as we adore and praise and rejoice into the Eternal King? Hallelujah.
Eternity's King. Eternity's King is coming again. Though all the earth will fade away, his truth will remain.
Let's sing it again.
Eternity's King is coming again. Will fade away, his truth will remain.
His truth will remain. Hallelujah.
Let us adore.
Let's raise our hands this morning in our hearts.
Let us adore him, Jesus Christ is the before him, Jesus Christ is the Lord. Eternity's King is coming again. Though all the earth will fade away, his truth will remain.
Let us adore.
Let us adore him. Let us adore him. Jesus Christ is the Lord. Come and behold
music will continue.
Let us adore.
If you have not given your life to Jesus this morning, it's the time to surrender your life.
Jesus Christ.
Accept the truth of the eternal word of God this morning. Jesus has come at the right time as part of the big plan of God to save you of your sin and to give you an eternal life, an eternal hope with Him. Receive Him.
Let us adore.
Believe in Him. Repent from your sin.
Let us adore.
Change your life around.
Him, Jesus.
Don't walk
Christ
the way you used to. Choose God.
Lord.
Choose the ways of the Lord.
Come and
humble yourself before the Lord.
Him.
Accept
bow
the forgiveness through Jesus' death
him
on the cross,
Jesus,
and the new
Christ
life through His resurrection.
Is
and
the
for you
Lord
who are going through a crisis this morning,
let us adore.
Don't let this crisis discourage
him
you.
Let us
don't be afraid this morning.
Him.
Jesus is in control.
Is the
He knows
Lord
who you are. He's working
come
in your life. If He can govern
him
the universe,
bow down
if He can work in the hearts of pagan kings,
Jesus,
He can be with you in your storm and your crisis. He will pull you through. Trust in Him.
Come and behold.
Lord, help each and everyone in this room
bow
this morning
down
who is going through a crisis. That this Christmas
Jesus
may be the reminder
Christ
that God is in
is
control. You are sovereign. You love me.
Come and behold.
And I make a conscious decision this morning to
bow
trust
down
you
before
with my life. To trust you with everything that
Jesus
I have.
Christ
to trust you with my future.
Is the
in
Lord
Jesus' name.
Let us adore.
Let us adore.
Let us adore him. Let us adore him. Jesus Christ is the Lord. Come and behold him. Bow down before
celebrate your victory this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord.
You alone.
We celebrate your coming into our existence. We open our hearts. The door of our hearts is fully open, Lord. Come inside. Come in, Lord. Take your throne. You are the one reigning on the throne of my heart. My heart does not belong to anyone else but you, Lord, because you are the eternal King, the ruler of all rulers, the King of all kings. And on this day, every knee shall bow and every mouth shall confess, even unbelievers. And shame and then regret, eternal regret, they will have to confess and acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord. But for us, it will be with celebration, tears of joy, and shout that we will confess that Jesus Christ
hallelujah
is the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless the families in this church, that this generation of young people, the children, will learn this also in their own lives, in their school, in their friends, in their choices, that the next generation will know how to trust the eternal God. Bless the families. Lord, help us in our crisis. You are the anchor.
Hallelujah.
And the storm, the victory. When Joseph was going as a slave, when the famine came in the land, you had a time, you were testing Joseph's heart, you were at work behind the scene, and you had a bigger plan. And Lord, help us as children of God, believers, with the help of the Word of God and with the help of the Holy Spirit, to grasp insight into the bigger plans of God when we go through any sorts of situations, when we look at the headlines that takes place in this world, that we know that our God is working behind the scene, and nobody will ever stop Him from fulfilling the purpose that He determined in advance. This is the kind of God that we worship this morning. In Christ Jesus, our Lord. And everyone says, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's give a clap to the Lord this morning.